Hello, I'm Paul.
I'm Laura.
And this is our Passive Pad. This row home is in the middle of a block. It's on historic Pine Street, which is near Rittenhouse Square. Rittenhouse Square is one of the four parks that defines the layout of Philadelphia. This particular block has a distinction that the cornice is continuous all the way from 17th Street to 18th Street. I suppose first and foremost, let me give you an overview of how this building is used.
Right, it's a four-story building with a basement. Before the renovation started, there were three residential apartments on floors 2, 3, and 4. This first floor was a commercial space. It was happened to be therapist's office. And the basement was really for storage and mechanical with a mud slab, low head height. After the renovation, we still have those three renovated floor apartments on the upper three floors. This first floor that we're sitting in right now is now also a bi-level apartment. That's our owner's apartment. This first floor, which is our apartment unit A, is one enclosure. And then we combine the second, third, and fourth floor plus the common stairway into the other enclosure. We're standing in the common hall and stairway for the building. And you can see that we're looking towards Pine Street. So that's the main entrance to the building. These double doors are historic. We opted not to replace them because we didn't think we could ever make them airtight and have them look like this, certainly not to get permission from the Historic Commission. And we kind of like them. And there were other complications. You know, these stairs that come up that are behind this glass door, also from 1924, difficult or impossible to air seal that. So from a passive house standpoint, we're outside right now. The door behind us and this wall are enclosing the Unit A passive house.
We're into all kinds of interesting cooking. Paul likes to make
kombucha and natto.
And we make our own granola.
We grow microgreens in the basement.
So, you know, having a really good kitchen that is useful and that we can all both work in without bumping our butts like we did in our last kitchen. Since this passive house is all electric, we have a Frigidaire induction range, which we love. It's not one of the high-end ones. It was, you know, sort of towards the lower end of induction, glass top induction cooktops. We have Energy Star appliances.
One of the things that we did not do is to have dedicated makeup air into the kitchen for the range hood. Just physically, it'd be very difficult for us to be able to bring in air and to exhaust air. We have a very narrow alley in the back. And so even for the ERV air intake and air exhaust, we're kind of, we have windows, operable windows up above. So, you know, those recommendations and requirements for separation between intake and exhaust it has really hampered us to be able to do some things that we would like to do. So instead, we do have a recirculating microwave hood.
The other thing is we have a booster switch, which is right here, which boosts the ERV.
And then part of what we did was to integrate the ERV in a fairly central location. And so we hid the ERV in these cabinets so that we have access. We do change the filters every 3 months. It's part of our protocol. And so this is a accessible but not too accessible location for it. And it keeps things, it sort of balances the requirement that we be close to an exterior wall so that as we're bringing in and exhausting the air, we're reducing those duct lengths as much as possible, but also having the manifold for each of the individual spaces for those flexible 4-inch tubes. It's a pretty good place to allow us to get down to the basement as well as the entire first floor.
When you do a renovation, the costs are often not the passive house envelope. that are adding to the cost. They add some, but really it's all the things that you discover in a historic renovation that you have to deal with. Every project that I've ever worked on, passive house or otherwise, has opportunities and constraints that you have to work within. And it's just a different set of opportunities and constraints. And once you understand and learn them, you know various benefits that you get. Some of the wonderful things you get with passive house is, one, you get these wonderful deep sills, of which I have painted window sills way too many times. And we've taken the opportunity with these nice deep sills and is in order to put stone sills on every apartment. So I don't have to paint them anymore. People can put their pots or whatever on them and it's all okay. They just clean off. The other wonderful thing you get with passive house is you get a vermin-free house. We don't have mice. I have chased mice out of this house for decades. Every fall when it gets cold, but we just look like a rock to those mice and rats. They don't come in our building because they don't recognize us as having any food, any smells, any warmth that would entice them in. Oh, the other thing is radiators, right? Except for the few places, and we use them as towel warmers as a luxury item. Our walls used to be cluttered with great big clunky radiators all over the place. We don't have those. So you may lose a little bit of space because of the insulation, but you get freedom of your furniture design and your layout of how you use the space because you don't have to be worrying about all those big radiators.
One of the best aspects provided by passive house is the quietness. You know, we barely hear the trash truck. Like we
this morning we were like, it was our week to put the trash out, and then we just,
and they're right here by the time you hear them instead of hearing them when they're down the block.
This is a great place for sleeping, right? Because yeah. It's quiet. There's the temperature is consistent and comfortable.
Those kind of comfort, quality of life issues, which aren't aesthetically visible, but are definitely enhance one's enjoyment of the space, are the kinds of benefits you get. It's hard to advertise that because until you've actually experienced, most people are skeptical that it'll really be that.
But we're also finding that, you know, indoor air quality, the ERVs, you know, there's an epidemic of asthma, people have mold allergies, all those things which are health aspects. And we're finding that actually has a lot of resonance with our tenants. They, like most people, they come from places where their own tab mold, where they're noisy, where they're drafty, and they come in here and you can feel the difference when they move in. They appreciate the difference, the comfort, the quietness is, you know, it's probably the biggest thing that you notice right off the bat. Yeah. Whenever you walk into this house.
Cleanliness. I mean, we don't have to clean as much. I mean, we do have cat hairs that happen, but the amount of dust that you have in a normal home is hugely reduced. So, you know, just that urban grit that comes into your house through all those leaks is not happening. So it's a lot cleaner environment just in general and takes less maintenance in that regard.
Okay, this is the second floor apartment. We call it Unit B. It's a two-bedroom, two-bath, and you'll see it has a beautiful kitchen. This was the owner's apartment that was part of the renovation of 1924. So it's got high ceilings, it's got big rooms, it goes floor to floor. So in the front is a beautiful bedroom that overlooks Pine Street. It's a relatively noisy street. It's got those new passive house windows, so it's nice and quiet. And the exterior wall is insulated against the same brick wall, and it's insulated with cellulose at the interior, an air barrier on the inside of the brick, and then that Intello dense pack air barrier at the holding up the cellulose.
When you exterior insulate on an old building, one of the things that a lot of preservationists will say, well, you can't insulate because you're going to cause more freeze-thaw. Normally that's true, but when you air seal appropriately, the inside face of that brick, either if it has a really good plaster covering, that's a good air barrier, or there's air barrier products. We used spray-on Prosecco, which is kind of spray or rolled on. There's also Viscon. There's various products that are liquid applied. Stow Gold is another that you can apply to the surface and air seal it. And then we build our stud wall, and we do not have it touch that wall. We have a break of about 1.5 to 2 inches. And then you put a membrane that's a smart air barrier on that surface. So now you have vapor open but airtight that you blow insulation into. We used cellulose. Then we put battens that go in the opposite direction horizontally over top of this membrane that's on the studs. And that is a service cavity so that you can get your electrical wires, plumbing, various things that don't have to penetrate that air barrier, that smart air barrier membrane. And then you do drywall on top of that. So this is a layered system that is, when you do the hygrothermic models, which are models that look at the passage of both moisture and temperature through your building, how heat transfers through the wall and how moisture transfers the wall. You see that the wall is a very stable wall and is allowed to dry out in either direction, whether it's the sun that hits that brick and dries it out from that way, or your air conditioning from the inside. And this is where we put the two ERVs. So the one for this unit is here in this closet and easily accessible for the filters.
One of the things we had to do because we have
a fire escape here is that we had to have a fire rated window, and there wasn't a passive house fire rated window. So as you see, we have a wire glass fire rated window on the outside, and then we have a Energy Star window on the inside, and the Armatherm product is the liner between that helps with some of the thermal bridging. So it's not exactly triple pane because that space between the fire rated window and this is larger than you would want for an actual thermal pane, but it's like a major storm, an air sealed storm window, and then an Energy Star window in front of it. So it's pretty energy efficient. It's as close as we can get in order to take care of both that fire rating and thermal requirements.
This is a great example of a typical called the Philadelphia floor. So you see it's face nailed oak. They're about 3/8 of an inch thick with some walnut trim accents. And you can see that there was a wall that was right here between these two walnut trim pieces. We try to maintain them wherever possible, but that's one way of sort of telling the authenticity of a Philadelphia row home, is because this floor is ubiquitous. It's people just know what it is, and it's often kept as long as you can.
So one of the first projects I did living in this smaller apartment was to put a roof deck on here. When we renovated 20 years later, that roof deck was a little tired and we thought we were just going to be freshening it up, but we discovered that the whole roof had been roofed over 7 layers of roofing, including ballast, and it was collapsing the bay and various other things. And so, again, it wasn't the passive house that was necessarily the extra charge. It was finding out that there were errors in construction, and suddenly we had another nearly $30,000 hit. So what we did is this lower deck in the lighter shade is private to this unit. And then this upper deck is for common use for everyone.
One of our experiments as we were looking at this project was to use this material here, which is cork. It has a stained finish on it, so it doesn't look like that sort of dark brown cork that you normally think of. But it has a lot of great properties, right? It has an aesthetic finish, it's insulation, it's waterproof,
and it's carbon negative. Those are all great things. However, when we put it up here, it doesn't seem like it's the right material for us for this urban situation. And so we'll sort of chalk that up to experience and learning. So, we're going to keep it. We like it, but I don't think we would use it for this building. We had considered using it for the continuous insulation that we would put on the lower part of the house. But I think we'll use something else instead.
Although you can add a stucco surface to this. You can use it as a substrate.
We have blackberries and blueberries and raspberries. And then back here, we have our kitchen garden. So we've got carrots, eggplant growing. We have a zucchini about to be picked. And so we really enjoy our little urban farm here. That, I think, sort of concludes our tour, and we really thank you for letting us share our passive pad with everyone and how we enjoy having this building, how our tenants enjoy it, and the satisfaction that we've taken a building that is 170, almost 180 years old now, and hopefully given it another 100 years of life.